Nobody else needs to die. We can go. We can get out of here.
Welcome back to another Jay's Movies review. Today I am reviewing the movie Wind Talker. That is correct. Wind Talker with Nicolas Cage. Now let's put it this way. Nicolas Cage is a captain in the Marine Corps and he is supposed to keep hold of this area. It's called Solomon and he's supposed to hold it at all costs until other people come and relieve him of duty, in the sense of they're helping him and he can go back and get some chow and whatnot. So he is there and his platoon, as I'm going to call it, is being destroyed completely. Everyone dies except for him, which is a miracle. Now, as it goes, his name is Joe Enders, who is played by Nicolas Cage, if you don't know that. Nicolas Cage plays as Joe Enders. And so Joe, he is attacked with a bomb, with a grenade, where the Japanese, they smash it on their heads and they chuck it, and lo and behold, it explodes near him and his left ear is damaged and part of his face because it's been singed off, but like just the skin, and he has problem hearing in his left ear completely. I mean, it's so bad that he always remembers what happened back then, because it is just a tragedy that he lost his platoon, and without falling back to a better area where they could regroup and everything, and he just stayed there, and he's the only one who survived. So he wants to get back in the army because he is taken out into the army hospital where he can recover, because his equilibrium, which causes him to move, to be able to stand straight, is whacked off, because when you lose part of hearing in your ear, you got to compensate for that. It takes time. And so he is trying to walk and he wants to get back into the army. So the love of his life says, you know, I will help you at all costs. That's including losing her job. By when he has to do a hearing test, she would just put a thumbs up to say, hey, you know, like beep. And he would say, yep, like, okay, I can hear it. And so they do that and they test him out and he's fine. He's able to go. So he goes back. He goes back to the army, to the Marine Corps, where he is in charge of what is called a wind talker or a translator. Now, let me tell you one thing. This is all based on a true story. The storyline is based on true stories. So as it goes, he has to take care of a wind talker who is a Navajo Indian, they use their language to send coded messages back and forth from one person back to the Americans, okay, like to head command, and where they are able to find about troops movements and stuff like that, where the Japanese can't figure out how to break the code unless they get one of these Navajo Indians who understands the code. And lo and behold, the mission for Joe is to protect his wind talker, who his name is Ben Yazzie, and protect him at all costs, no matter what happens. So if he gets captured, you got to kill him, because you don't want the code to be broken and the Japanese will be able to understand what's going on. So their mission is to take over Saipan, which is a big island where they can get a nice army base and they can get planes in, so that it's easier to attack the rest of Japan and Tokyo and stuff like that. So lo and behold, they are attacking Saipan and they're losing a bunch of men. I mean, they're going back and forth, losing people and everything. And as it goes, at some point in time, Yazzie's communicator explodes. Okay, he gets shot by a shell where it, like, the fragments hit his communicator and he can't communicate with anybody. He can't tell anybody anything. He can't virtually do anything. And lo and behold, the Americans are shelling their own men. They are literally killing their own men because they don't realize that the Japanese are a lot farther up on the hill, and so they are getting attacked completely. And what Yazzie says is, you know, we're going to go and get a radio. We're going to go and get a radio from the Japanese because, you know, I look like a Japanese. Okay. And so they're, and Joe is like, no, that's the craziest idea. You're not going to do that at all. And you got a guy named Gunny who is like, wait, I want to hear this. Cause he's the main leader of the group just above Joe. And so he hears about the plan and he's like, okay, go do it. So Joe says, I'm going with you and I'm going to be your capture. I'm going to be your prisoner. And so Yazzie goes and he takes Joe to the Japanese and beats the crap out of him to some degree. And finally, Joe goes and gets the weapon out of the back of Yazzie's pants and he shoots the Japanese to get to the radio. And so Yazzie gets to the radio and says, okay, and finds the frequency that he needs and he goes, hey, like, he's like to whoever, like he says, like Arizona to whoever, you're shelling your own boys, you're shelling your own guys, stop, cease fire and all this. And so they stop and then they give coordinates. And so Joe looks on his map and says, okay, these are the new coordinates and they have to get off that hill because the Americans are going to redirect their shots over to the hill. And lo and behold, they get off the hill as they are firing at them. So they like jump in the air and they're like, boom, and they survive. Now, as it goes, they go and they keep going around and they find a village at some point in time where you got Charlie Whitehorse, who is one of the other Windtalkers, and he is playing music with the guy who is supposed to watch him and protect him and everything. And so they're playing music as I'm going to say the Navajo and the American, so you understand who I'm talking about. The Navajo plays the flute and the American plays the harmonica. And so the American plays his harmonica and of course the Navajo, Charlie Whitehorse, comes in and plays with him and it sounds amazing. I mean, who would ever thought that two different people from two different places could actually make great music, and they do. And so, lo and behold, they think that the whole entire village is, like, Japanese-free, other than, like, few people who live there. And lo and behold, it's not. So they are attacked. And Charlie Whitehorse is fighting off men as much as he can, and he runs out of ammo. And so he uses his knife, and he is captured by the Japanese. And his partner, who's supposed to watch him, dies because he's been shot a few times. And then you get Joe, who finds out that Charlie is being taken, and he shoots a grenade and blows up the Japanese and Charlie Whitehorse, who is the Windtalker, so that they could protect the code. And Yazzie comes back, and he's like, well, where is Ox or Whitehorse? And, well, lo and behold, Joe says, I blew up Whitehorse. And he's like, well, what do you mean you blew him up? Well, I blew him up. I took my grenade, I shot it off, and I blew him up. And, you know, that's when Yazzie finds out that Joe's mission is to protect the Windtalkers at all costs. That's even including killing them right there on the spot because of them being taken prisoner and the code being broken. And so Yazzie is pissed as can be. I mean, pissed as can be that he goes and he runs in fire, like he's running in like the blazes of hell, the best way to put it, where he's taking his gun and he's shooting all these Japanese and everything. And Joe's like, hey, Yazzie, come back. And he's not coming back. And so Joe goes after him. Other people go after him. You got Gunny. You got two other people. You got Chick and Papas, who goes. And they're all just like gunning down Japanese as much as possible. Gunny dies. And you got Chick and Papas who are still there. And they survive. But lo and behold, you got Joe, who is shot one time in the one time in the arm. And you got Yazzie, who's shot in the leg. And then you got Joe, who gets shot again. And he's just there on the floor, dying as grenades are being shot out and everything. And Chick and Papas are there, and they're protecting them as much as possible. And finally, Chick comes out and says, you know, it's over, it's done. We've survived and all this. And lo and behold, Joe is dead by that time. Joe is just gone because he's been shot. He's bled to death and there's nothing that can be done. Yazzie survives, and you see him, he goes back, he's back with his wife and his child, who his name is George Washington Yazzie. Like, I mean, who names their son George Washington? But, I mean, understanding naming them George, but not George Washington after George Washington. And so he more or less says, you know, to his son, you know, if you ever talk about Joe, say he was my friend. Because literally, Yazzie says earlier in the movie, do you have any friends? Like, you seem to not care to have any friends. But lo and behold, Yazzie is his friend. And Joe dies. Well, Joe's dead, as we all know. And Yazzie is more or less giving, I guess, a Navajo prayer, I would say, to Joe to, like, maybe rest his spirit or something. I'm not exactly sure. But in the end, it ends with them in Arizona. And it's a great movie overall. I mean, it is just a movie that you can sit, you can watch. I mean, yeah, it's a lot of pack action, blood and gore, and there's a lot of swearing. So, I mean, you got to be careful with that. But overall, it's a great movie to see what it was like to fight against the Japanese, even though, yes, it's Hollywood and it's not completely accurate 100%. But, you know, it is still a good way to see what it's like to be a Windhawker, to have a code that you have to learn about what a tank is, what a plane is, what this is, what that is. And, you know, they have so many different codes that they have to remember that it's crazy. But, you know, it worked. It worked for a long time. It worked during the Japanese, and then it worked against in the Korean War. I mean, it was great. It worked. That code was never, ever, ever, ever broken. Not even some of the Navajo people could break the code, even though they spoke the same language. They could not break the code, because if you aren't in the briefing of what things are, you're not gonna know. And so it's just great overall. So I really recommend you go and watch it.